Good afternoon. I'm from micro and nanotechnology, and when we talk about micro and nanotechnology, we are talking about replacement technologies to what we have today. We're talking about pushing barriers of the, what present day's technology can do. And what I want to show you is that within the energy area, we are doing so as well. And where I come from, it's from the Technical University of Denmark. We are collaborating a lot with industry. So what I'll be showing you are some examples of technology and examples of projects where we are collaborating with industry within the energy area. And I've taken the liberty just to concentrate on the projects that we have at the Technical University and especially at my own department, DTU Nanotech. And the first example that that I want to show you is within sensors. There's a trend that, sensors needs to be everywhere. We want them everywhere to monitor whatever, and we want clusters of sensors. We want them in houses, we want them in many different things. And the sensors should, of course, be able to sense. We should be able to get the signals out, get the signals out, and also to transmit those signals to wherever we need it. We also need energy for that. And we can do a lot of wiring, and or we can put in batteries, but that is something that is going to wear out. So what we are working on is actually to make energy where the sensor is. And what we are doing is actually harvesting energy at the place. So how do we actually do that? We make some small devices that consists of a spring and some mass. And whenever there's some vibrations in the surroundings, that vibration can actually be transferred to this. And then on the other side, we've got some piezoelectric material, which will then give out some electrical current. And that's how we're actually harvesting energy from the environment where the sensor is. And it doesn't give a lot. It gives around up to 70 microwatts. So that is for sure not something that's going to solve the world's energy problems or anything, but it's something that is going to give enough power that we can actually make one measurement, let's say, one every 1 minute or so. So we can make a sensor system that is not relying on power from anywhere else, but actually on the spot, and can do so for a very long time. Oops. And we can make them in different geometries, so we can actually fit it to the environment that we are working with at the time. And we can put many of these energy harvesters together, so we can have them fit whatever vibrations regime that that we have around us, and actually get them then to work with the microcontroller, acceleration sensor, wireless communication, etc. That can send the signals off to a mainframe computer. This is something that is happening. It's not just something that we're thinking. The energy harvesters are being developed by a company, Meggitt, and we have a project with, together with the big windmill manufacturer Vestas in Denmark to actually put these sensors at the tip of the wings. Of the mills, because they want to actually see what is happening at those places, and getting wiring out to those tip of the wings is a cumbersome job, so we don't want that. So this is just one example of such technology. And as I said, it doesn't bring a lot of energy to the table, but what it does, it actually increases the performance of, for instance, the windmill, so we can optimize the output of a windmill. It increases the how we are constructing, optimizing our houses. We can get them to last longer. And that is very important when we are talking about energy, because a lot of the energy that we are consuming is due to material usage. So if we can actually get our things to last longer by using this kind of technology, we come far. We're also working in other replacement technologies, and one is to try to eliminate the batteries from, for instance, hearing aids, making microfuel cells. There's a lot of challenges in actually making microfuel cells, but once we get it done, then the Danish hearing aids companies are standing next, or we're actually in collaboration with them, and they want to take over this technology and actually put in these microfuel cells that runs on the methanol. And so you can actually top off the hearing aid whenever you get to lunchtime, or when you have your Sunday snaps at the retirement home or whatever. We're also working with photovoltaics. This is a slide that I got from one of my colleagues from the Department for Energy Conversion and Storage at the Technical University. We have three generations of photovoltaics going. We have the well-known silicon technology, and we are also developing the plastic or organic photovoltaics. We have, with the standard technology, up to 15% to 20% module efficiency. It's a proven technology, etc. The new generations still have something to show, but that is what we are working at. We have cell efficiencies of 10%, which only gives module efficiency of 2% to 5%. But it is potentially much cheaper technology, etc. What I want to show just two glimpses of is, with the present technology, how can we actually improve that so we get even more out of it? That's one road to take. And the other one is to what is the work status on the organic photovoltaics. So on the existing technology, what we are working on at our department is to actually increase the absorbance of the light. And what we do is actually to make the silicon black, the surface. We make a surface treatment to the silicon, so we actually make it black, so it reflects less. And it's a process that we have. It's a plasma process that is made during making the solar cell. And what it does, actually, it improves the efficiency, and it is at a lower cost. So if we can put in that kind of technology, there's immediately money to be made. Whoever gets that money, I don't know, but that's other people to worry about. Oops, there you go. The other one, the polymer solar cell, is a new or more recent technology. I said it's all plastic. So it's potentially very, very cheap. Still, it doesn't have the high efficiency as it should have. It should reach 10% in printed modules to be a viable technology. It should show 10 years of lifetime and should show high-speed production. It does part of it. The efficiency isn't high enough, but we're working on that. The high throughput production is there, more or less, now. And it is environmentally friendly process. There's a lot of water-based printing in it. It is, when you look at life cycle analysis, when it's very good in that sense. The energy payback time is can be down to 1 day on solar cell like this. So where are we? We are right now where we have some small scale applications of this technology. We should get out here where we have can use it as a very big source for energy. If we don't hit the energy part of it, then it's no use. But we are working on it, and just showing some examples that I got from my colleague, demonstration project in Africa, where these solar cells, they can actually use it, they can store a little bit of energy and actually have a light bulb running in the evening so they can still read. In the more funny parts, we also they gave out some hats to the Roskilde Festival in Denmark, but that could actually power the mobile phone, so the parents still could reach the kids at the festival. I have another example, which is a flashlight made by a Danish company based on these solar cells, and it does actually light. Well, maybe you can't see it here. Oops, yeah. It's coming along. This is, of course, the solar cell technology is about making electricity where you are and at that time. You also would like to actually be able to store that that energy that you are making. You can do that within photocatalysis, where you can make direct water splitting using the sunlight. I don't want to go into that, apart from just showing where micro and nanotechnology gets into this part. And that is where when you are designing the anode and cathode, you can actually make the anode and cathode much more efficient if you are able to make edge pillars like this. And that means that you can go to lower grade silicon, and you can actually go to other more abundant catalysts, when you are making the anode and cathode. And the other thing that it brings you is that you can actually make small micro reactors where you can test the different catalysts. And so you can do that very quickly. You can ramp up temperature and whatever and whatnot, so you can make a lot of tests in a very short time and make that very reliable. So that is where we also are bringing in some technology to this energy area. Completely different thing is light directional elements. Within the micro and nano technology area, we can also make some redirection of light using gratings. And in a European project where, for instance, Saint-Gobain is part of, we are working on that by of redirecting the light. So you can actually get more light to, for instance, to the ceiling of a room or deeper into the room. So you can actually avoid pulling the curtains during the day or having to switch on the lamps at the back of the room, etc. And you do that by actually putting gratings into the window glass with gratings which has an irregularity in it. And you can actually see one example here where we've gotten some switching of the light into the ceiling and thereby maybe avoiding usage of energy. And you can actually make that switchable in with different techniques as well. Once you're at it and making these gratings into the windows, you can actually couple some of the light into the slab of the window. So you actually get light going along the glass in the window and to the side. And if you have a very high efficient solar cell sitting there, maybe the polymer plastic solar cells sitting there around, then you can actually get a little energy harvesting system running there. There's just one example shown down here where we illuminated the blue laser onto a grating on a piece of glass and see that the light goes to one side. So there's a lot of stuff to play around with in that department. One last example is sensors that can be used for improving the environmental and economic performance in the marine combustion. The fleet is is facing that they have to reduce NOxes by 80% in a few years. So what they have to do is to look into how can we actually control how we burn the fuel, and how can we make it much more efficient how we burn the fuel in the ships. And they need some online monitoring for that. And the online monitoring is, in a sense, a very simple system. It can be built up by infrared emitter and a detector. And then if you have some filter elements, then you can do an algorithm, and et cetera, and you can actually, in that way, get out how much NOx gases you have in the exhaust of the ship. However, being in that environment, you will pretty soon get whatever you have in there covered with soot from the exhaust. So what you need is to have some protective sight glasses, some encapsulation of your infrared emitters and your detection system. And that is something that we can do with nanotechnology, because we can actually make some self-cleaning windows that also have anti-reflective coatings on them, etc. And with that, you can actually make very cheap detection systems that will sit in the exhaust of ships. That's all from me. Thank you for your attention.